All right. So, good afternoon, everybody. Hopefully your lunch won't put you to sleep, because I'll guarantee you what I'm going to share you won't put you to sleep. And that's what we need, isn't it? We need to awake from the sleep. And we've got to all realize we've got one eye partially closed, okay? You call it what you will. We can call it our journey, or we can call it transition. We can call it whatever we want. But the ego always denies that it's an ego. You talk to somebody about the ego, personality, first thing they say is, I don't have an ego. Yeah. Well, that's the ego saying that. That's the first thing the ego says, I don't have an ego. That sounds like a cornflake commercial or a pancake commercial, doesn't it? Oh, it's ego. Let go of my ego. Let go of my ego. Quit messing with me. Yeah. Gabriel McCurdy, a lot of you met down in Georgia, just sent us a quick note, and I just loved it. I wanted to share it with you. He said, love you all so much. I'm so grateful to be hearing this. I didn't realize how much I missed y'all until last night. Hardly know y'all, but it's cool how the love you share can make you love and miss someone you hardly know. Y'all know I'm with you in spirit. Hello to all. And he was a small, short guy, real good looking. Came down to Georgia. He sort of popped in at the end. So I think Gary met him and some of them met him. And he connected with us, connected with me through Tony. And of course now he's listening to Gary and Robert and is having a good time. So I certainly want to thank Gary for his invisible words yesterday about me. And Robert, I love his language and his southern humor. Periwinkle is my favorite color of crayon, and he called that one out. Out of what? Thousands of colors. I know it. Periwinkle. That's a little easier to say than incorporeal. Yeah. And one of my favorite words is bullshit. It's one of my favorite words. Because it cuts right to the chase, doesn't it? And maybe it's not always friendly, but sometimes that's what needs to be said. And I want to thank Gary for being my friend. He talked about how I was his friend. And I don't know anyone that's more patient and kind and loving than Gary Sigler. He's quite a networker. And he always has the disposition to stay connected to everyone. Now, not everyone has stayed connected to you guys, right? We know that. But I mean, if you look on his site, he's got hundreds of people that have ministries that aren't teaching the truth, and they're still on there. And that takes a special disposition, but we're all in a different place, aren't we? And so we've got to be tolerant of where we're at so we can help get to where we're going. If everybody got the revelation and the vibrational frequency I received in Hong Kong today, we would understand more clearly what I've been sharing to you. But it took me several weeks to get where I could even share it with you. Mm-hmm. Okay? Do you see what I'm saying? It's going to take meditation. It's going to take a concentration, but what happens is you get this sensor, this vibrational frequency that vibrates, and you don't forget it. We can call it cosmic, we can call it whatever, okay? It doesn't really matter. But it doesn't mean that we all agree. That's what I'm trying to say. It doesn't mean that Gary and I are on the same page with everything. But as long as there's that love and kindness and understanding without judgment, we can all get together and fellowship so we can be raised to a different place. Okay? And Robert Shirtley was sharing that. We can't be in a more loving setting than right here. Right? We can't be in a more loving setting than what we have right here. And so I can be open and share the truth with you, can't I?
Yeah,
that's what I'm going to do. Because it's only the truth that will set you free. And because every one of us are in a different place, I do not expect all of you to see what I saw in its entirety. Matter of fact, it was without words. That's what I saw. The understanding that there's never going to be an event that happens in this world that'll help you in a lasting way is not going to come to you overnight. But what we need to know is that until we see the incorporeal nature of our being, we will never be able to know the world the way it is known of the Father within you, who is you. There's no way. This has to come from within you. I can't tell you to do it. This has to come from within you. Now, I use a lot of notes. And there's a reason for this. And it's because I don't want to talk to you. There's been enough of that going on. What I hear when it comes is so real and so pure, I have to write it all down when it happens. Mm-hmm. I've got dozens of notes, dozens of recordings. And then the Spirit leads me to what to read. It's amazing. It's magical. Mm-hmm. And it's so exciting to be led in each moment to prepare to share with you. So there's a lot of density in what I bring to you because I go through literally each message and I go through it again and again and again, and I weed out and shift and twist and move stuff around so it comes out the way it does. And each time I look at it, I see something else. It's wonderful. And it gets richer and richer and richer. And that's one of the reasons I don't like to meet every week. Because when we meet we meet five times a year. When we meet, all of the revelation I've heard since the last time we meet comes together, and it always piggybacks off the last message from the last meeting. That's why I sent out to everybody, listen to Jesus did not come to save humanity. Well, you couldn't say that in any religious setting. And I had people on Facebook busting me just for the title of it. And that's okay. So, like Robert was sharing, I want to break bread with you. That was beautiful. So that we can understand what it is that needs to be laid down. Because that which can be shaken will be. In order for you to find your incorporeal self. So, why do we need these words? You know, we're having trouble saying it. Okay? So I want to help you. It's incorporeal. You want to say it? Let's say it. Incorporeal. 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 Man, the man upon the earth, every man upon the earth is corporeal. And always judges after the five senses. We've never known any better. Who's ever taught us any differently? We're talking in a foreign language right now in these meetings. I'm surprised we can even use words, to be honest with you. And that's why it needs to be somewhat redundant, where we say the same thing in a different way so that it can attach to that thing that is corporeal, that's holding you down. But we need the word incorporeal because the word spirit is abstract to us. Yeah. What does spirit mean? You have to define it. And incorporeal defines it the correct way. It says spirit, spiritual, discarnate, bodiless, non-physical, immaterial, and immortal. Now, we like the word immortal, but we really don't experience immortality. Because probably all of us are affected by the passing of people. And we call it death. And there's no such thing. No incorporeal spirit has ever died. And that's what every man, woman, and child is made up of on this in this world right now. No one has ever died. Now, Tony said that to me years ago, and I didn't know what he meant. But he would say it over and over again. And I thought, well, that's nice to believe, but here I am running to the funeral crying when my dad left, you know? And that's okay, but we have to realize, where is that coming from? Where does that come from? It comes from the ignorance of a corporeal five-sense man. It's just pure ignorance. People still are talking about the grave. People in our groups are talking about a grave or bypassing a grave. There is no damn grave. Gary and I love to go smoke cigars in the cemetery. It's the quiet. You know why I go there? Because it's really quiet. It's very quiet. Now I want to go a little deeper into the corporeal man. Anything that you can think about yourself or sense about yourself is corporeal. Anything. This is why Jesus said, take no thought for your life. No thought. Not some thoughts. Well, that's a lot of whacking going on, isn't it? I mean, talk about getting out. You remember the old grass sheaves we used to have? Back when lawnmowers didn't run real well all the time, sometimes you had to go cut with a shot. I remember my dad had one of them great big sickles with the long hook. That thing was useless. I don't remember how sharp it was. It never cut the grass very good, you know? So I got that little one with a whacker, and I'm whacking it. The little one's cutting it better than that great. I couldn't swing it fast enough or something. I'm just telling you, it never worked. Useless piece of crap, okay? But that, and it's sort of the same effect that we have on our sense of mortality. Not immortality, mortality. We're still mesmerized and think that people die. We are. I had a whole message on it back in March on what is life, and I said, incorporeal spirit can't be killed with bullets. Life can never be destroyed, Walter Lanyon said. Life is life. And by its own definition, it's eternal.
That's right.
You can't do anything to affect real life. And there's only real life. Yeah. There isn't temporal life. Jesus said everybody that lived in a temporal realm was dead. He said, let the dead bury the dead. That's very insulting. How many times have we heard people say, after some of the most horrible ordeals and events in the world, maybe sometimes years later, oh, I think I can see God in it. Years later, years of hell. Later. I remember even some people talking about what happened at 9/11, saying, you know, I can really see the Father working in things now. Now. But what if you knew who you were and you found yourself in the thing? You knew it couldn't touch you. And I'm not talking about magic. I'm not talking about walking through walls or any of that stuff. I like to think more of the martyrs who knew themselves. And here they were taken and burned at the stake. That's the challenge of faith, isn't it? They knew. That's why were they singing? They were singing on the way to be burned at the stake. Because they knew this. They knew this. They knew nothing could touch him. I like to think of the story of Stephen, who said when they began to stone him, what did it say? He went to sleep. He laid down and went to sleep. Did he feel the stones? I don't know. But somehow, how do you go to sleep when somebody's stoning you? It's a question, isn't it? How do we bring incorporeal spirit into a corporeal world? That's what we're going to talk about this afternoon. How can we walk in this world and not be of the world? And that's what I really want to focus on to help you. And we're going to talk, of course, more about some of the same things. But one of the things that we need to talk about is nothing can be processed correctly until we understand that passing time is not real. How could I say to you, no one dies? Because there's no such thing as passing time even, let alone a passing life. Now, a life's a long time. Life's eternal. How could life, real life, pass away? And it's hard for us to get around the understanding that there's no such thing in passing time. But we've talked about quantum physics. Einstein's the one that made the most wonderful revelation, and I've quoted him many times. He said there is no distinction between the past, the present, and the future. Absolutely no distinction. And they saw it in their microscope. They saw the proof of it within the atomic structure. Because as you go to another level beyond what can be seen with the atomic movement, they found another level of activity that's invisible. It's invisible. It's amazing. It's wonderful. So, your world only exists within your judgment that you perceive with your five senses. We have to understand that. Your world. And everyone has a different one, and we need to be patient with all of us heathens that have a world, okay? I like the word heathen. I love being called a heathen. You know, it's probably when I got beer dripping down my beard and my cigars sort of half smushed, and there's a heathen right there. Now, my picture of a heathen is like a medieval guy that's all drooly and got a great big old turkey drumstick, you know, and eating with his hands, you know. That's sort of my picture of a heathen, you know. Right? Is that pretty good? Is that pretty close? Yeah. In reality, wherever we have judged from the senses, there has only been the invisible spirit of the Father dwelling in you. Always. Never left. It's never went anywhere. And it is always judging the world in righteousness and loving kindness every microsecond. That's the vibration of the Father within you, which is you. Now, if you're not in line with that, then you're not in line with yourself. The Father, the vibration, the highest vibration there can be, is to judge the world in righteousness and loving kindness. That's the highest there is. Whatever that frequency is, 20 zillion billion, okay? That's the highest frequency you can have. And I'm just so thankful that that was the revelation that came to us in this ministry. And I remember walking out in the, I was going through airports a lot then, more than I am now. And I had these rules, you know, when you were in airports, things that you shouldn't do. Because we need to be courteous to each other. You know what I'm saying? We really do. And one of my pet peeves is you never pass anybody in a moving stairway. Some of you have heard me say it before on recordings. Never pass someone on a moving stairway. It's dangerous. It's dangerous. And the week before, this revelation had just come over me, and the Spirit was going to test me. So the next time I'm in the airport, here comes this maniac as we're going down probably one of the longest stairways at DTW, because they're long over there, and he's in some kind of freaking hurry. And I got my suitcase behind me, and I'm a wide guy. There's no room. Here he comes running. He's just expecting me to just fall over and get out of his way, and I didn't move. Sorry. I'm still learning, okay? Forgive me. I did not move. He began cussing me, calling me everything you could think of. It got somewhat abusive. And we got down to the bottom of the stairs. I saw a security guard. I went over and I said, "This guy is harassing me." And she looks at him, and he looks over, and I realized I was the problem. I should have turned into a transformer and got as skinny as a piece of paper and got out of that guy's way. Shouldn't have I? Huh? Why wouldn't I? It's me. It was me trying to pass me. Now, I'd have a hard time with passing myself. As big as I am, I'd have a difficult time with that. So I better get out of my own damn way. Because that's really what it is, isn't it? You are me. I'm you. There is no separation. This is why there can't be anything you add or tag to the name I. Nothing. You can't say I am and add something. As soon as you do, you're crucifying yourself. You can't. And that's, we're going to talk about that a little later. That's going to help some of you that have difficulties with some of the things in this world and some of the language we speak that holds us down. Are they just words? I don't think so. I don't think they're just words. Your home is right now in the infinity of the universe of spirit. And that is where you will find reality, and you cannot find it anywhere else. It has to be unconditioned by anything that could happen in this world, or could happen to you, or anyone else. It can't be conditioned by anything that's corporeal, or could be out of a corporeal world. It cannot be, and it's not. It is not. So, you see, in reality, we really know that there's no such thing as passing time. We've talked about it. It's beautiful. Just the feeling of saying that raises our vibration level. But it's impossible to comprehend that with the human mind, that there's no such thing as passing time. It's really impossible. But as we enter into the now of our kingdom, we will realize that our Father sees the kingdom complete and filled to the brim with all of His love. There is nothing left to seek or desire. He can only see Himself in all, and that is all that is needed to know. If you just come back to that. My kingdom is not wanting for anything to happen tomorrow. It's not waiting for something to happen tomorrow. The kingdom is complete and full. And He says, and you have all things for life. You have all things for life. It's the same thing. It's the same kingdom. Now, a gal wrote me named Vicky Ray. It's not Martha Ray or whoever's on TV. It's Vicky Ray. It's not Rachel Ray. Vicky Ray, I think, is another Canadian. I think she's from Michigan or Canada. She wrote me and is seeing what I'm talking to you about right now. She says, "Hi, I watched your videos And then I found in my Kindle Fire Joel Goldsmith book, Invisible Supply. It's a good read. So I started reading it yesterday at 10 p.m. and I could not put it down. Then I picked it up again today, and as I was studying, these two verses came to me in Acts 17 and John 17. Something rose up, and in the stillness it said, "You never left. You are still within the Father." All of this is illusionary, and when we awaken to truth, we find that we never left the Father. We have always been in the One and are not separate from Him. We have our being in Him. We walk and move and have our being in Him. The awakening we find is that we are still in Father and never left. Father told me that He was the total of Himself, and we are His character and nature. Now in the conscious awareness rises up an awakening that we never left and always have been in Him. When the total of Him is in these bodies, the flesh fights against the spirit, but we are not a flesh body. We are in the Father and bringing all things under the Father. Now, let's talk about that just a little bit. We never left the Father. What does that mean? You can never leave the Father. You can only leave the Father in your mind. That's what it's saying. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Omnipresence is never in the wrong place. Mm-hmm. You can only be in the wrong place in your mind. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
Only in your mind. Yeah. And in the five sense world of judgment. What do the five senses do? Always, are they're never telling us the truth. They're always saying this is good or this is bad. Always mark it down, write it, tattoo it. The five senses are always telling you this is good and this is bad. Okay, you're not that person. It's telling you you're not you. It's just your mind that's being tricked. That's all it is. Okay? Thank you, Vicky. Now, one thing that a lot of people have said is they like it when I share stories of my weaknesses, and I try to as much as I can so that people can relate to me. I'm not any different than you, okay? I want you to understand that right now. I don't feel any different. I might feel a little more invisible when Gary carries on like he does there, but I know better. I know better. And I've been through a lot, but I'm not going to tell you about it because then you want to tell me your stories, and then we'll fight about who's been through the most. Right? And it doesn't matter. You've never left the Father. Ever. Ever. And as our mind begins to move out of what we call time, we'll begin to see that. There's no beginning and no end. That beautiful?
Yeah.
So when I went through the fireworks campaign this last year, I went through a really tough time of depression. And I'm not going to get into the details of it, but there were four nights where I stayed up all night without sleep. And so I'll confess to you, I have a very small level steroid pill I take for flying. It's a very small dose. And so I would take one of those about midnight for four nights in a row to try to help me stay awake. And it worked pretty well. But I mean, when I got done, I crashed. Because I quit taking them. You can only take them about 7 days. You can't take them more than that, or it starts to affect your body in the wrong way. But I need it because my ears are so tiny when I fly. It expands my blood vessels and stuff, so my ears don't get plugged, and it really helps well. But anyway, I'm just being honest with you. But it set in on me, and I couldn't shake it. I knew what the source was, but at the time it seemed impossible to escape to me. I couldn't figure my way out of it in my mind. That's what I'm saying, right? Somehow I just couldn't figure my way out of it. And a still small voice came to me after about 2 weeks of really suffering with it. And it said, "What are you thankful for?" And I began to focus on these things, and all of it began to disappear. In the silence of thankfulness, it began to lift me up out of this depression. And I'm not sure I was really thinking about a lot of things. You know, it wasn't like I was dwelling on a ton of negative things, but I was sort of in no man's land. Do you know what I mean? And all of us have experienced these kinds of things. And I want you to know I'm just like you. I'm going to go out to a corporeal world when these meetings are over, just like every one of you. And I'm going to face it. And it tries to pull you down. And with everyone, it tries to pull us down. It does. It's okay to admit that. But now we're beginning to hear a different way. A different way to understand it and to deal with it. Depression really comes at the core of it from an identity crisis. We chase our thoughts into a spiral of depression. People talk about being depressed, but the issue is that there is still a me, a personality, an ego, and a body that really hasn't been broken yet. So this laying down Robert was talking about, this breaking of bread, we do it every time in remembrance, which really is the same thing as Paul talked about when it said, pick up your cross daily. So you have to lay down your body. Whatever you find yourself, find a way to be thankful in it, and it will begin to break the torment of it. I promise you, find a way to be thankful in it. Don't try to get rid of it. Don't try to escape it. That's the problem. When we're trying to escape it, we're magnifying the problem. Yes. See? When you, Tony always would teach, resist not.
What resists persists.
That's right. And so when you get, and then the thing about grab it and blab it, well, let's just deny it and do positive thoughts. Well, that just makes it bigger. You can't deny nothing.
It's all for
you. You can't deny nothing, right? My worldview and your worldview is really just a hologram of images formed by the judgment of good and evil. Five senses. A hologram of images in our mind. Do you know how real my dreams are?
Scary.
I've shared some of them with her. I don't know how I ever get any rest. Because I dream all night long. I'll have 4 or 5 episodes sometimes. And I'm still giggling about whoever it is that's the director of those dreams. I'm giggling like hell. I just wake up entertained and sometimes just couldn't repeat what I dreamed about. And some of them have been the strangest concoctions. I remember I dreamed of lions one night a while back, and I had watched a video on crocodiles versus lions. And the crocodile really didn't win, but he got gnawed a lot. You know, sort of at the end of the thing, the lion said, you know, this is too tough. I need something more tender. And they finally gave up, you know. But the crocodile was pretty maimed. But that night, I dreamed about I was fighting 2 or 3 lions. You know, and I had their jaws, and I was spreading them apart like Hercules, you know. And they gnawed on me a little bit. Then one of them got my hip, and I woke up. I was feeling my hip, you know. Because, I mean, right when I wake up, they're still real to me. I still think I'm in them. Yeah. My wife's come over there. You want some coffee? Rawr, rawr, rawr.
He's hilarious.
It takes me a while to snap out of it. Holograms of images. I'm not the authority on this, but we need to be careful with dreams. They're really just part of the psyche, you know, and it's really a hypnotized state. So I wouldn't put a lot of value in them. I'm not saying it's never, ever true, but I don't pay attention to mine. I know that. I know I don't run out and try to find some lions and fight with them the next day, you know. We really have been attempting to live in a time warp. We're called stars many times in the Bible. In many writings, we were called stars. And I like to think of this body as just really a starship that carries us from one world to the next. It doesn't mean you ignore it. It doesn't mean you go out and start beating on it like you're some kind of Gnostic Christian. Right? Mm-hmm. But when Jesus says, take no thought, what's he saying? That's all you're doing is taking thought. Mm-hmm. That's what he's telling us. Yeah. Break it up. Give it a break. Mm-hmm. That's all we're doing. So Brendan Laidlaw from the Gold Coast of Australia. A lot of us know Brendan. Sally, I've seen you chirping on his wall. He sent me something about this. I thought it was beautiful. It says, depressed? ? A personal condition. Actually, the person is the condition. A seed of thought believed becomes the tree, and its fruit, in this case, is depression. A cure? Treatment? All a pruning of that very tree. Only removing the tree will reveal the underlying foundation of all conditions. Only then does the depressed become deep rest.
Say that again. Depressed.
Only removing the tree will reveal the underlying foundation of all conditions. Only then does depressed become deep rest.
Oh, that's nice.
So, what's he saying? The tree is the problem. The identity is the problem. Because when we go through all these conditions, there's always something following your I. I am. I have. I don't have. I need. I want. I desire. That's your problem. Is you're calling yourself by another name. So mark it down. Just mark it down. I don't care how much it hurts anybody. It's true. I found it to be true in myself, and I know it's true. Why is it true? Because you are an everywhere spirit. There is nowhere your spirit is not. Your spirit. And until this settles down in you, you will be drawn back into a sense of mortality. So again, how can we escape this world? And I've got some more. One is, realize your body needs to be broken and quit complaining about it. It should be something you tell no man. I'll be honest with you. It should be something you tell no man. You should, I've learned this. I've only told you guys, but I went to the hospital one night. My wife was sleeping, and I had some beers and a bunch of fried fish, because Catholics are crazy around here for the Friday fish fry. We got 20 Catholic churches and 5 million Catholics in a town of 40,000. And everybody's got the all-you-can-eat fish fry Friday night. And I never go there, but I did this night. And my heart began to palpitate like a lot of pregnant women get, where your heart gets racing and it's called a centrifugal pump. And it gets pumping up to a certain level. What is it, Liz? She said last time what it was.
Turbulent.
But it wouldn't. It got pumping so fast, it kept itself going. It wouldn't slow down. I'm sitting there, my heart's beating 195 beats a second.
Arrhythmia.
Yeah. I've never had it before. I felt okay. I didn't have a headache. My blood pressure was fine. My heart's going. So I wake up, and I know if I wake up my wife, I'm not going to make it. I just went and hopped in the car and drove myself to the hospital. Driving fine. Went in and said, my heart's beating like crazy and it won't stop. So they literally stopped my heart to reset it. The whole time, I was at total perfect peace. The whole time. Was never afraid, was never nervous, was never wondering if I was checking out. And my wife didn't even know. That's what I mean by tell no man. I don't want to have to deal, he's going to die, look out, you know. He's got to get the paddles, you know. I didn't have to deal with any of that. That's why I'm telling you, talk to no man about these issues and quit speaking life into them. Quit speaking life into them. Quit saying they're real. Stop it. You just got to shut the hell up. That's the first step. And begin to be thankful no matter what it is. No matter what it is. Find your silence and your thankfulness, and it will begin to go away. I promise you. So how can we escape the world? Here's another nice tidbit. We no longer have concern. Now listen, this is a big one. We no longer have concern for the world that the Father did not create. That's a big one. Teach me thy ways, O Lord. Thy will is done in me. And a quiet voice will begin to take over, and it will begin to direct you through the world. Even though you are not of it. I'm promising you, it's working for me, guys. This is working for me. You will no longer let the cares of this world steal away your truth and your joy and your peace. When it comes, get still. Get still. If you got to go in a closet, say, shut the hell up, Nevins. I always talk to my devil. We talk about the devil and the demons. They all live in my brain. That's where they're at. And my brain does need to be saved. This is the accuser of the brethren right here. And it's the only place he is. This is the serpent. This is the father of lies. It's all right here, in between my ears. That's a busy place in there. It's very busy. Yapping. I mean, there's enough yapping going on when I'm by myself and nobody's yapping. Amen. Isn't there?
Yes.
You live in this incorporeal universe. This is the only place you can live. It's it. So we need to understand what this means, because it helps us get away from that abstract spirit that we've never seemed to be able to get our hands around. I'm spirit. I am. And then I go on the website and there's big long blogs about sorrow for poverty and all the things going on in the world. Okay? I'm sorry. We can't go there. We cannot go there anymore. You have to turn from what you see with your five senses and realizing it's not reality. It is not reality. It's an image in your mind is all it is. That's hard to take. That's a hard teaching to take. But it's true. When you live in the incorporeal universe as the incorporeal man, accepting your neighbor as the incorporeal man, then you are fulfilling the divine law of love. You see your neighbor as yourself. Then you're fulfilling. What did he say? This fulfills all the commands, is to love your neighbor as yourself. Quit seeing a starving man. Quit seeing a dying man. Don't look at it anymore and see that's what it is, because it's not. And that's the thing that's hard with the five-sense man. This is the thing we've got to escape to live within our kingdom. This is going to be the hard task for us. But I don't run my business anymore now. What a relief. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's sing the doxology. I don't run my business anymore? Nope. You don't have to run through airports anymore, Mike. Remember the Hertz commercial? Yeah. You don't have to run through airports anymore, Mike. The Spirit said, you don't run your business anymore. Great, you can have it. Whoever that is. You don't run your marriage anymore. You don't run your household anymore. The Spirit of love in you lives itself through you and guides you through the world as you. And all you got to do is shut the hell up. All you got to do is be still and begin to find your thankfulness in silence. Find your thankfulness. Find your thankfulness. Find your thankfulness. Find your thankfulness. How many times have we bitched? Say, find your thankfulness as many times as you bitched. And then you're only back where your head's just above the water. Okay? Find your thankfulness. The five-sense man judges the hell out of everything. There's no way around it. I grew up with a mom that's yelling and screaming, never happy. I was well-trained. That's why we never wanted to be in the house. I'd get home at a kindergartner, and if my mom wasn't right there, I ran off and hid behind a bush till she come down and couldn't find me. Michael Olin, where are you? I never would answer her as a kindergartner, because I didn't want to go back in that house, because I had to do stuff to clean my room, and I never cleaned it good enough. Hundreds of times throughout Scripture, we see the word turn. What we don't know is that we've always seen the word turn to mean a change of behavior. Yeah. And that is not what it means. The Hebrew prophets meant, and if you'll dig into this deep enough, I should talk to Alan Newton about this. If you look deeper, they were telling us the word turn really means to turn from the belief in the visible corporeal world to the ever-present invisible incorporeal world. To turn from the sense of mortality to the awareness of immortality right now. The only place you can know immortality is now. Immortality has no time. It can only be now. You'll never find it tomorrow. Now that should help you get a sense that there's no such thing as passing time. We certainly have no trouble dragging all the hell of our history into the moment. We have no problem with that. But just think about it. I've said before that love has no memory. The Spirit of light and love has no memory. If you had no memory, you couldn't judge anything. Think about that. Because you'd have no reference, you'd have no bitchin' reference point. Would we? Whoops. Ouch. My wife says, rouch. With an R. Rouch. That's a double, triple ouch. Rouch. That's sort of our dogs, a mixture of our, because we live with the dogs so much, you know, rouch. It hurts, but it's reality. This turning is revealing the spiritual universe all around us. Do you know when I was in Hong Kong, what I felt was just a little baby glimpse of the glory that we're going to experience. It's just a baby glimpse of it. It's just the beginning. I'm telling you what, it was powerful. It took me over. When I heard that the whole world lives in my five senses, a weight lifted off me. I feel it right now as I say it to you. That the whole world lives in my five senses. And that my world only lives in my five senses and nowhere else. That's all I can tell you. It just went whew. I get the goosebumps right now. I guess that's vibration, right? Is that when your skin goosebumps? Wow, that's what got me. Yeah. It nailed me. It drug my ass to the ground. Holy crap, that's good stuff. You know? Now, what is that, you know? Talk to me. Tell me. I can't believe I'm sharing a message this soon on it. To be honest with you, it's shocking me because it was so fresh and new to me. And I'm going, you're going to teach this? I said, uh-uh. I need to meditate on this some more. But here we are, and out it's coming, and it's going to keep coming till we get it, right? And so, this turning it talked about all through Scripture was talking about the revealing of a spiritual universe all around us. The universe that is not perceived by the senses. The command of Jesus, take no thought, was telling us the same thing. It's all the same thing. It becomes so consistent. The Scripture begins to open up to you in such a new and different way that you find out meanings that are layers deep from all the damn literal meanings that every religion's tied to them. It don't mean anything like it does when you just read. You can't just read Scripture. I loved Robert's rendition this morning. I've never, ever thought of it that way. But wasn't it beautiful?
Yes.
Thank you, Robert. Is he awake? Robert, we loved it. Thank you. Take no thought for your life or what you shall eat or what you shall put on. That's a lot to not take thought for. But isn't that all we do? Hmm? Hello? Flonk. F. Repeat. Go back to school. But what he was telling us is to leave the five senses world which cannot perceive the now of reality. This really is helping us. This really is helping me to understand the source of my problem as I'm believing my senses. Yes. I'm thinking they've been telling me the truth, and they've never been telling me the truth. Yeah. Ever. Ever at any time. That's wonderful to understand that. And so this is why the corporeal man is called dead and dying. Because we are asleep or prodigal or unenlightened to this truth of incorporeality. The word that I've used a lot is separated. I've got a lot of messages, you know, the cause of separation, you know. I've got a whole series on it. Separated from the realization that you are the spirit of love and you've never left, Vicki told us. I believe her. I said, we've never left. Only in our mind, only in the imagination of our mind, following our senses like a mad dog, do we leave the reality of the kingdom. Only then. Nothing's lost. Hmm. Nothing. Nope. Nothing can be lost in the kingdom, and that's all there is. It's the kingdom of love. Nothing can be lost. Wow. Joel stressed over and over again, talking about the divine consciousness of who you are. But the five senses has fooled us into thinking we were conscious. And that's what that German, Dirtchoff, told us. He said, we're in a waking sleep. Because we're walking and talking and moving around and we think we know something. He just sort of summed it up. Well, Einstein said, how long will it take a man to realize he don't know shit? Whoops, I changed the last word. The moose translation, yeah. How long will it take us to realize we don't know anything? Nothing that you can process with your mind will reveal to you an incorporeal universe. Nothing. That's what it says right here. What we think, nothing we can think, no thought we can take will reveal to us who we really are. The wonderful part about it is as we learn about this incorporeal spirit, we now have the keys to hell and death. We can begin to escape that because we know what it is. It's my own damn mind. My own mind is the Doberman Pinschers. 10 of them chasing my ass. Huh? Got 5 of them at least, don't we? Taste, touch, smell, touch, and sleep, and snore, and hear. Or whichever ones they are. Right? There's at least 5 Dobermans. We got to get a hold of them, get the pliers, and pull their teeth out. Right? The five senses has fooled us into thinking we're conscious. But some of us have had the vision. I guess we call it a vibrational intuition. That's a cool word, isn't it? It's sort of like, what was that? Yeah. I think I heard something. Yeah? We saw something, but not with our eyes. We heard something, but not with our ears. Well, what was it? It is the calling out of our sleep where we begin to move into conscious awareness of the incorporeal universe. That's what I felt in Hong Kong. That's what I'm telling you about now, that we've been walking outside the doors of the kingdom. We've been close. We've heard music. Hopefully it's not some Christian hymns. Yeah. So we're not impotent then, because we're not dependent on this world. We're not helpless in the sea of human disturbances because we begin to see them for what they are, and that's nothing. Nothing. We have to begin with our own. So unless we find the now of our spirit everywhere, it cannot spin out its perfection. Right now, every man, woman, and child is in the incorporeal, invisible spirit, right now. And they are one with you when you know the one indivisible spirit of love. We no longer then sow to the fleshly thinking, stinking, thinking mind. Until there are no days anymore. Time will be no more. And the only time you ever have a sense that there's no such time is when you're not in a hurry.
Yeah.
Relax. Some call it the fourth dimension. Tony wrote a book on the fifth dimension. But it's real, and it only exists in the now of your incorporeal world. Yeah. Peace be still. Fear not. I am with you as you, and there is no other besides me. Who's talking? Who's talking there? It's you.
Yep.
It's you. There is no other, he said. There isn't two. That's our problem. There is not two. Even saying we're in union with God is really a misnomer. Because then I still need help from some God that might be close to me, but he isn't me. And who would ever thought that I'm God? Well, you're not God. You're the spirit of love, unconditional righteousness. That's not a God, okay? Because the word God means to control. You're not a God. And we have to be careful interpreting that scripture. Okay, because you're not the God that any of us have ever thought who is a God. That ain't you, okay? That ain't it. Peace be still. There's no one besides yourself. Huh? Wow. It is I, and it's always I. Right where you are right now is the everywhere I of your being. Right now. This is your name. It's a short name, isn't it? We've wanted to add syllables and how many in the Facebook you got? I know Willie's one of them. What's hers? Willie, Wildebrand, Spence. She's got four names on there.
Wilhelmina.
That's a lot of, yeah, Wilhelmina, yeah. Wildehand, Spence, and Fart, and carry on. I mean, it's going to take a lot to get rid of all them names, isn't it? There is nothing behind I. I am, and that's it. That means a lot. It means you're spiritual. It means you're discarnate. It means you're bodiless. It means you're non-physical. It means you're immaterial. It means you're immortal. It means you're infinite. That's what I means. Incorporeal spirit. Get used to the word. Start looking it up. There's other people that teach it. I got an email yesterday from a gal that says she's studying Hare Krishna Maria Hirahi somewhere, who wrote a book on incorporeality. It's probably a good read. She's coming at it from some other Eastern religion, like Gary was talking about. Reading about it, she says it's beautiful, it's wonderful. Now, the one problem is, they put at the end of the title of the book, Incorporeality for Healing. You gotta whack that off, okay? You gotta whack that healing word off of there. No, 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 no. And that's why I had to whack Joel's book all apart, okay? Sorry, Joel. If he was here, he'd say amen. I know he would, because he is here. He's my spirit in me. And he'd be excited to know that we're rising up higher,
yes.
That we're no longer going to go back to the pigsty where we're looking for something. Anything. And that's where you'll find your direction is in the silence. I was talking to Rex about this. It's so, so important that we don't go back to discussing our conditions with anyone. Well, this is why Jesus kept saying to him, don't tell anybody. I've just told you the secret. Tell no man or you're going to lose it. And what'd they do? They went out and blabbed it around to everybody, didn't they? And then they had to come back the next day, didn't they?
Yep.
Had to come back the next day. This is your name, I am. Full stop. And so when the corporeal world presents to you its nature, here we go, stand still. In the invisible perfection of your eye, and behold the salvation of the Lord now. Now. And if you've lost yourself, that's great. Yeah. because that's the self that's causing all the problems. If you've lost yourself, it's great. The more you can't find the you, the more you're going to find the I of your being. You're not living in a certain year at a certain time. It's only a concept of the human mind fueled by the senses. There is no corporeal creation as we know it. It is we who entertain a corporeal creation as real. And with it, all the judgment that comes with it. Now, I can prove it to you, because if we all wrote our definition down, none of them would be the same. So how could it be real? And this is why we got 10 zillion friggin' denominations and 4 zillion religions. So if something happened to you because you understood the real I and something in this realm left you, if you blab it to somebody, you're going to have to start running a church. I'm serious. That's the thing we don't want. Oh, they did this and that happened. There's never a pattern.
That's right.
We're all in a different place. We're all having a different experience. And it's your I experience. And it's just yours, and it's nobody else's damn business. Keep it to yourself. Okay? And they call, oh, I got this, my ass hurts, and my knee's twitching, and my toes throbbing, and what do I take? Oh, shut up and call me in the morning. That's what I'm going to tell them. Shut the hell up and call me in the morning. Do you know how many times things have happened and you just go to bed and sleep and it goes away?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, that's right.
Huh?
That's true.
That's something, isn't it? Where's that tell you it's coming from?
Exactly.
Now, just be careful. I'm not trying to tell you magic, okay? Just remember, we're not going to start to have groups of practitioners working with people. Okay? I find that very, very important. And it's the one thing that was missing from the infinite way, is they never really followed through with that first revelation or that first love that they got. At the beginning was wonderful. And then it all got worked into some kind of ministry where you have to pay. I'm not kidding you. I have a lot of people that write me saying, Mike, I've been talking to practitioners. And the only place I found myself is broke. I'm just out a bunch of money. And they say it's my fault. It's just witch doctor work. It's all it is. Just you might as well get out your little rod and look for water in the ground. Now you can do that in Michigan because we got water everywhere. But you go out in Nebraska or western Colorado, you ain't going to find nothing.
Great Lakes of Nebraska.
Yeah, there you go. So, if you've lost yourself, it's great. Fear not, I am with you. If you've lost yourself, it's because you don't know your I. Isn't it? Huh? We're back to identity again. Your true self is timeless. And your true self includes all the years that man will ever live. Ooh, that's a good one, isn't it? Wow. And it's all here now, in the eternal self that you are. So you no longer rest in world thought, in the good and the bad of yesterday, the healthy, the unhealthy, the rich, the poor, the opposites. But rather, you are abiding above the sense world,
yeah.
Above the five senses world. This is where you find yourself in your right mind. In your right mind. Remember the story in the New Testament? It's where you find yourself in your right mind, which knows the Father aright and begins to see the incorporeal creation. And you literally begin to walk in your new consciousness. You then have stepped out from all the problems of the world. And only see the pure righteousness of the kingdom here and now. This is your reward and peace. Guys, let's quit judging the world out there. you got a big enough basket on your own to deal with. Start at home, turn off the TV, get yourself in line with yourself. Okay? Get yourself in line with yourself. We have no business talking about what's happening in Afghanistan. Okay? It's not real. Okay? It is just not real. Nothing in the kingdom can pass away. Are we believing that all our brothers are as us? Are we believing the love of the Father when it says you have to love your brother as yourself, be perfect as your Father is perfect? It means we see everyone as ourselves, and that means they can't die. That's quite a faith leap, isn't it? Huh? That's a big leap of faith. And so take no thought, take no care for the things of this world. Don't let it rob you of this truth. Bring it home. Just come home. How can I help you realize the kingdom right here and now? I just got an email from somebody who's not realizing the kingdom. I'm going to read it to you. Thank you for your teachings. I think. I have discovered your site and all the info there, and it speaks to the divine confusion. Okay. I'm experiencing now, it speaks to all the divine confusion I'm experiencing now. I am so lost. I am at war within myself, and the more I try to express what I'm learning, the harder it is. My family thinks I'm nuts because of what I'm entertaining, but I really know I'm one with the Father. I really want a true and real experience with God, but right now everything is just good information. How do I make this real to me? After spending some time on your site, where do I begin? Is that not our story?
Yes.
Huh?
Yeah.
And here's the secret to living in the Christ consciousness is the ability to have a relaxed mind. The ability to have a relaxed mind. The ability to have a relaxed mind. Now, relaxed mind isn't judging anything. Hello? Hello? Come in. A relaxed mind isn't judging anything. This is your Christ consciousness. It's never in a hurry because there's no such thing as passing time. It's never in a hurry. You ought to see me putzing around in my 700 horsepower race car now. Driving the speed limit. That's a sin, I'm telling you, in that car. That's an absolute sin. I got a GTO out there. 421 six pack. 450 horse. It's just sitting there. I never drive it. Yeah, there you go. What do you got? Ooh, I love the Road Runners. Wow, I love the Road Runner. It's got a Road Runner. Listen, I love the Road Runner. They'd never stay together, though. Every time we went and drag race them, they'd always blow their engines. They weren't made very well. At least the engines wouldn't hold together. All of them were sort of crappy then. We were always working on them, weren't we?
Yeah.
How old are you?
53.
Okay. Okay. I just wondered how you were connected to that car. So I'm a little older than you, but how do we find a relaxed mind? How are you going to find that? Well, you got to quit judging. You got to quit listening to your five senses. You got to realize this is not you. Right? You have to realize. We can just say words all the time. We can repeat all these words that don't mean nothing. You have to find your relaxed mind that desires no thing. Desires no thing. What can help you? Take a pill of thankfulness. Get a bottle and put some placebos in there. Right? Thankfulness pill. Swallow it. and say to yourself, shut the hell up and find the relaxed mind. Find it. The relaxed mind can meet the problem in any storm, with or without. Now, what happens when something comes to us? Ah! Help! Is that time to do something? No. No. But our anxiousness is part of the problem. And I talked quite a bit about, in a message a while back, where I said, your answer to your problem is your problem. Because when a problem comes, we decide what's the best answer. And then we chase our answer like a mad dog. That's usually got to be the good part. Can't be the bad part. But when I shared with Ann, I said to her, Ann, the only place I know where there can be no fear is where we find the place where it doesn't matter what happens. See? Where it doesn't matter. You've got to get comfortable right where you're at with all the garbage and crap you've got on your shoulders right now. You have to become thankful where you find yourself to begin to walk out of this and find your relaxed mind. Okay? There can be absolutely no anxiousness or no sense of time there. Right? You with me? No anxiousness. Find your relaxed mind. Peace be still. Fear not, I am with you. And when he said it, there was a great calm. Now, we think they were really in a boat and waves were splashing. The waves represent the problems. The waves represent the turmoil, the troubled waters, right? That's what it's about. Everybody thinks we're going to go out and walk on the water now and flatten the waves out. Well, big deal. That isn't going to help you any. That's not what it's talking about. Until you find yourself in this relaxed state of thankfulness and silence, it is not safe to do anything. And people will write me and say, I don't know what to do. Well, then don't do anything. What's the hurry? You got your ass strapped to the back of an ambulance or something, or what? You know, the ambulances in England, they sound like elephants having an orgasm. You know what? I'm not kidding you. It freaked me out. I said, what's that? Here it was an ambulance. I was like, rah! I go, wow. He was just chirping it a little bit. You know, it wasn't the full-blown ambulance, but I was going, man, that's the craziest sound I ever heard. Never heard it that way. You know, it's the first. I mean, I don't know how else to describe it, you know, but sorry, I got off on a rabbit trail there. Sort of like what we scream, you know. Oh, well. It is I. Be not afraid. The secret to meeting all the issues of life is to meet it with the mind, is to be relaxed and stop seeking the answers to the problems. Let go of your answers to your problem. If you let go of your desire to manipulate a circumstance, you will find peace there. We cannot meet any problem with fear. We can only meet it with the eye that says fear not. Now, the only place you can do fear not is if you take away both sides of the good and evil. See, you've got to pull those out of the equation. I had to say to myself, is it okay if I lose my business? And when I got the grip of that, it quit dragging me around and controlling me. I'm serious. Now I'm finding out that I don't have to run my business anymore. I'm really happy about that, okay? Because it's not been easy the last couple years. As we walk in the light of love, that we are. We become invisible to the troubles of this world. And it's then and only then can we be directed in the silence of our I am. That's good stuff, isn't it? Huh? Find yourself in the silence, and you will guide yourself in the quietness and the stillness. It will direct you. Don't listen to your mind. Don't listen to your words. And just go within. And I promise you, you will be guided. He said, I will not forsake you or leave you. Because I am you. How can he forsake you if he is you? It's all in there, Maynard. It's all in there. That's why I love the Ragu commercial. She opens up and says, it's all in there, son. Well, that's you. Open the lid of your mind and all the bullshit and realize all your answers are in there. So let it all out. Let all the crap out. For I am God, the Spirit of love and life. I'm not a man. I'm the Holy One in the midst of thee. Hosea 11:9. I'm the Holy One in the midst of thee. Hello? Come in. When you find yourself in hell, I cry out to myself, help! Help! Nobody answers. Help! And the still small voices, what in the hell do you want now? Now what's your problem? It's all coming from within you. Isn't that beautiful? Everything you need is within you. Everything. There's nothing missing. You don't need to cry out to a God somewhere outside you and try to impress him. The Father has never not been in the midst of thee. Vicki Ray told us, the Holy One in the midst of thee, and there's nothing else. She just told us. We've never left the Father, and the Father's never left us. Ever. Amen. Ever. 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 What's happened is we've been trained up in a society, in a world that just focuses on the five senses. I'm absolutely, totally flabbergasted at where I find myself today versus when I was driving down a mountain road in 1986 and I just left the church and I just cried out and I said, whatever the hell this is, it's not working. That's all I said. And a new journey began. Now, I wished it wouldn't have taken 25 years, but then there's no such thing as time, is it? I'm going to stop bitch about that, okay? So, I want to talk more about some things that I think are important. Sort of like a living workshop right here and now. I want you all, please, all of you love me, right? So I want all of you to consider looking beyond the activities or possible events that could or might take place in this world and take a long drink of the living water that I know is truth. If we're chattering about this is going to happen or that's going to happen, you must realize it's all coming from a corporeal sense of life, okay? Not the incorporeal world that you've been introduced to this weekend. I do not care if it sets well with you because it never will set well with the natural mind. It's never set well with my mind either. We're all in the same boat, okay? It never has. But we've got to leave it. We've got to walk away from it. We're all going to go out, okay? in a few days, and we're going to be walking back in our corporeal world that we lived in before we came to these meetings. Okay? I know that. And that's why if I love you, I want to help you. Okay? I want to give you some tools that are going to help you. Okay? Your judgment of the corporeal world that you came here with, okay? Whatever you came here with, we must realize it's your world. It's your own personal world. It's not anyone else's. It's a world you formed with your concepts through your five senses. And everyone's different, okay? And that's okay. There isn't any more love that you're going to get than with these people here. There isn't any other safer place where we can be honest, right? And find our honesty and realize it doesn't matter what happens out there. It can't change this. It can't change this, okay? So, we're going to be faced with a challenge, right? Do you leave that world and go to your Father? That's the challenge. Jesus said it all the time. The Father within you, which is you, does not see it and has no care about the activities going on into this world. How do I know this? How do I know this without a doubt? And I'm going to tell you. Because the Father is only seeing the world in righteous judgment and loving kindness. And he sees nothing else but himself. Why? Because he only sees himself in every man, woman, and child. He does not see the starving man. He does not see the dying man. He does not see all the trouble that you see in your corporeal world. He doesn't see any of it. Hallelujah. He doesn't see it on any level. So the only way you can get in line with yourself is for you to stop judging the hell out of your world. That's the only way. And this is your victory. To walk in your new incorporeal world in peace and love without any concern for what is going to happen tomorrow, because that's what happens when we get concerns. It's always about the future, and nobody can live there. Hello, come in, please. Come in, everybody. Come in, please. Come in. Nobody can live in tomorrow. Hello, are you there? Is anybody out there? Got my eyes closed. I'm going to plug my ears. Nobody can live in tomorrow. Nobody. That's the only place any of our concerns can have any value, is if we place them in tomorrow. Nobody can live there. The Father doesn't live in time and space. Of course he loves the earth. He gave it a spin and called it all good and took a rest. And you want to know something that blows our minds? The earth has never not been here.
True.
The earth has never not been here.
Amen.
If it came out from the Father, it has no beginning and no end.
Yes.
It's never not been here. Your world only exists within your judgment that you perceive with your five senses. So the world outside you with all its activity only lives in your five senses. And when you withdraw from the natural five sense man, it disappears.
Yes, it does.
Now you need to write this down if you're thinking to any degree that anything needs to come to this world. Because you're either living in fear or you're wanting to be somewhere else. I like it in Michigan. It's pretty nice. But if you don't like the cold, you'll be bitching in February.
That's right.
See? There is, the only place that's perfect is in your kingdom. And you take that with you everywhere. And so it makes every place the perfect place to be.
That's right.
Doesn't it? The Father sees his kingdom within you complete and sees all the people safe and eternally in that kingdom right now. Can you believe that? The Father isn't inviting anyone into his kingdom anymore. He sees everyone in. He sees everyone in. No one needs to be saved. The only thing we need to do with the world is stop judging the hell out of it.
That's right.
That's the only thing the world needs, is for you to stop judging it. Can you believe that? If the Father is not controlled by time and space, and we all will reach out and say, yeah, the Father's not controlled by time and space, but we can't join ourselves to it. See, because we can't see that. But there's only one. He sees everybody in already, doesn't he? Mm-hmm. He has to.
Yeah.
He sees everybody in. Hallelujah. We don't need nothing. Shut up. Relax. Enjoy yourself. Find your thankfulness. Quit talking about your problems. It's all bullshit. It is. Sorry, it's a perfect place to put that word. Perfect place. Clean yourself up, pull your bootstraps up, and start being thankful, and in your silence you'll be directed through this world. And whatever happens to you, you will be directed individually and in a different way. There's no patterns. We don't need practitioners. You don't need to go to somebody to get healed. You don't need to go to anybody to get rid of anything. You take it the way you got it, and you start finding your thankfulness in it.
Yep.
That's your secret. And whatever comes to you, you deserve. In thankfulness. I'm serious. Whatever you get, you deserve.
Yep.
Yeah, you do.
Yep. Take it like a man or a woman. Whatever it is. Now, I'm going to read a couple scriptures that I love, and we'll be done. I am the Holy One in the midst of thee, and there's nothing else. Oh my gosh, that's so beautiful.
Yes, it is.
I'm the only thing in the midst of thee. There's nothing else. In God, the understanding of righteousness and loving kindness in you shall wipe away all tears from your eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. Now, the word pain there means bitching. Okay? That's what that word means. There'll be no more bitching. For the former things are passed away. The corporeal man's dead. He never was alive. Ever. He's dead on a doornail. He's an invisible ghost. He's a phantom man. He's an imposter. Never has had any reality. For the former things have passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. Well, when?
Now.
How can it be anywhere else but now? How can it be? I think we all can get around that. There's only now. Everybody, I think, knows you can't live in the future.
Yep.
Right?
Where nothing's
going to
happen.
That's exactly right. You ain't got shit if you don't know this, okay? You got nothing. Zip, zildo, zitch, zip. Nada, butkus. I make all things new. In your consciousness right now, you are complete. And he said unto me, you better write this down, because this is good stuff. It's true and faithful. When will this happen? When will you begin to walk in your incorporeal universe? And he said unto me, it's already done. I'm the Alpha and the Omega. I'm reading this revelation to you and putting in some translations, okay? Doesn't it sound just like I'm talking to you? He said, it's already done. I'm the Alpha and the Omega. I am you, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that athirst of the fountain of water of life freely. He that overcometh all the bullshit shall inherit all things. Huh? He that overcometh all of this, this is what they're talking about in overcoming.
Yeah.
Believing you're something you're not.
Yeah.
Is where all your problems come from. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. Well, we're not going to drive up in Ferraris and all that stuff. Don't get crazy on me. But you'll walk around without any needs anymore, and you'll quit bitching about it. You'll quit saying, I. I'm putting a grunt in there. Yeah. Overcometh what? The corporeal view of the world. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls, and every several gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. Wow. How would you like to see gold that was like transparent glass? You want to know what it's talking about? You.
Yeah.
You. It's you. You're the pure gold. You're the pure, the pearl. And you are as transparent glass when you see your real identity. No longer is there the fog and the darkness covering your eyes and your ears so you can't see reality, because you have ears to hear and eyes to see. And then, this is the key. This is the magic and the secret behind it. And I saw no temple therein. I no longer saw myself as corporeal. I saw no temple. I saw no body. I saw no human being. I saw no mortal. I saw no material, fleshly, carnal, bodily man. Why? Because the Lord God Himself, Almighty and the Lamb, are the temple of it. It's you. It's really you. Wow. You are the Father of light and love. There's nothing else. How could you leave yourself if you're it? You can't. You can't leave yourself if that's all there is. And it's you. You're just chasing your tail. That's all. And with a small dog, when they got a short tail, it's really exciting to watch, isn't it? Because they never quite get it. But that's us, right? And when you get to it, it's you. I say, wow, I'm sure tormenting myself for me. Huh? And the city had no more need of the sun, or neither the moon to shine in it, for the glory of your reality did lighten it, and the Lamb of your revelation is the light thereof. Yeah. Thank you, amen. So glad you guys are here this weekend.